uses a port called Djibouti for its export. Pulses is an important crop. Now, pulses is interesting in Ethiopia because pulses has a big domestic market also. Lentils, for example, is a big domestic market. You would be surprised to know about 130 days out of 365 days in Ethiopia, people are fasting. And those days, they don't eat meat. So the major source of protein, even in Ethiopian diet, is pulses. And within the category of pulses, chickpeas and the lentils is one of the, or they call it misal, is the major supplier of their protein. So a local market for these commodities is very high, or these type of varieties is very high. They have been trying to export chickpeas, but chickpeas in India is not, see, because of the size, there is an issue. But they export a lot of green mung beans, and they export major crop that they export, major variety they export is the red kidney beans. Last year, say the average, if you look at the say kidney beans, about 120 tons of kidney beans is being produced and exported. Majority of the kidney beans that is produced is exported. It is destined for the Indian and the South Asian market. Last year, things have not been say so good. The production was there, about 130 to 140,000 tons of red kidney beans were produced in Ethiopia, but because of the fumigation norms and the say the fumigation, say I would call it the disagreements between the fumigation processes within the two countries, the exports were significantly low. So that's there. Red lentils, as I said, and desi chickpeas have a lot of domestic consumption. So not and whatever goes is the chickpeas actually goes to the Middle Eastern and the say Pakistani market. We don't in India, we don't import that much of say chickpeas, or the Indian markets do not consume that much of chickpeas from Ethiopia. The average price of chickpeas was about 600 to 700 US dollars FOB Djibouti last year. This was say. This was in the light of say the pressure on the chickpea. The prices of chickpea shot up significantly in Ethiopia, but then they started to recede back, and this was where the year ended. The Ethiopian calendar actually starts after May, so May, June, July is the time when they have the major rains. Ethiopia has two rainy seasons. One is one which starts from somewhere around December, January, where they have short rains, and then in the long rains, they call it, start from May and June, and that is when the harvesting happens, or that is when the sowing happens rather. So at this point of time, given the market movement of prices, there is an uncertainty about how much would be grown this time for the Indian market. But yes, average production, we are expecting the rains have been normal. At least Ethiopia has not been affected by the drought. So the rains have been normal, the short rains have given a good indication, so we are expecting the late kidney beans and the other crops to be at the average production levels. So that's how Ethiopia is structured. Kenya, pulses account for 11% of the daily calorie requirements, and second to cereals, again a local market is there. Green pigeon peas is consumed as vegetable in Kenya. So the pigeon peas are grown in Kenya, but they are not processed, or they are not actually consumed or exported as pigeon peas or as dal, but it is consumed as a vegetable. Pigeon pea is the second to beans, which is the say most staple crop in Kenya. The average price of pigeon pea last year was about $570 per ton, which was again the average export was about 14 to 15,000 tons of say pigeon peas. So Kenya, if you look at the quantum of export that they do, it's not a significant exporter. This year, the Kenyan crop is expected to be further low. Already, the government has declared a drought in Kenya. So the production, the maize has severely been affected. The pulses, the sowing has been delayed because of the rains and because of the lack of rains. Another issue which Kenya is facing right now is the shortage of seed. The seed prices have shot up significantly, making the farmers move to other crops. And the conventional farmers who actually grow seeds, who actually grow pigeon peas as vegetables, would continue to grow that. But the export market, the crops grown for export of these may not be that significant this year. But with that, I have to also say, recently the government of Kenya has developed a strategy which they call it as an export strategy for pulses, and which is destined exclusively for Indian market. So the government has spent a lot of time and energy developing a strategy how to grow more pulses that can cater to the Indian markets. So you can actually see in which new varieties have been introduced. Secretsar has been working with the government of Kenya, and recently the last leg of testing is going on for a variety of pigeon peas which would give 3 crops a year. So we are expecting more output coming in from Kenya. We are expecting more exports happening out of Kenya, but that is a long term horizon, not say for the say next year. If you see the mung beans, that's about 25,000-30,000 average export in Kenya. About 40,000 to 45,000 is the average production, which is exported about 30,000 to 35,000 metric tons every year. Mung beans are a smaller, say small variety crop, and or small in the sense short variety crop. So 2 to 3 crops come every year there. So that's about Kenya. Moving to Tanzania, again a major player in say commodity, say specifically pulses. One of the major export of pigeon peas. 2 varieties are exported from Tanzania, Arusha and Mutwara. Mutwara is actually a variety that comes in at a later stage. The sowing would happen after May. The sowing for Arusha variety, Arusha, Babati, these varieties are with the central region, which happens somewhere around say January, December. So that's where, again, Kenya has this year declared a drought. So last year there were issues, the pigeon pea production and the export of pigeon peas is roughly around 100,000 tons of export every year. That's an average export. This year the production is expected to be low, majorly because the rain has not been good. There has been a drought in Tanzania. There has been availability of the seed has been an issue. The seed prices have suddenly shot up. The seed prices, which used to have actually doubled, so it makes the Tanzanian farmers difficult to get the seed. And these countries, the production is dominated by smallholder farmers. So seed prices have significant impact on the production. So that's where the Tanzanian market stands. Significantly, since last few years, Tanzania has been exporting more crops to India. But this year we are expecting the prices. The couple of factors put together, what happened last year with the prices, the drought, the availability of the seed, everything. The expectation is that the crop this year that would be available for India from Tanzania may be about say 15 to 20% short. Malawi, this is part of the southern, it's borders with Tanzania, but it's part of the southern, say part of the southern part of Africa. It's a country that say produces a good quantity of pigeon peas. Average production of pigeon peas is between 18,000 to 1 lakh tons. Last year the production was up by 15-20% than usual. There were good rains, though other crops had significant 2 years of drought was there in Malawi, but this the pigeon pea production was much better. The major issue in Malawi is the logistical challenges, because the port that they use is in Mozambique, the Beira port, and taking the goods from say the production areas in Malawi to Beira, the cost is very high. So that's something that makes it a little bit of difficulty. The government agencies have stepped into Malawi to promote pulses. Government parastatal EDMARC. EDMARC is an agency that has the mandate from the government to procure the crops from the smallholder farmers across the country. So it has deep village collection centers through which it collects, and it is looking for partners who can actually partner with EDMARC to buy those crops, say for export. So what they lack is the export market, and that is where one of the opportunities are there. Some quantities of green gram and black gram is also grown in Malawi, but not very significant, about say not more than 1,000 tons of these, both the crops are available in the market. So the major still lies to be pigeon peas. This year again, Malawi, there were heavy rains in January, which has further delayed. We are expecting a better season this year. The sowing should have been started in March. Sowing has been delayed because of the soil preparation and the high moisture content, because of which we are expecting the sowing to happen somewhere in say next month or so. So at this point of time, the position about Malawi is not very clear, but we are expecting say the average say temperatures and the average rainfalls the crop should be reasonably good enough. Mozambique, again, another important producer in eastern southern Africa. Mozambique produces around 60,000, say average export has been about 60,000 to 70,000. And if you look at Tanzania, Kenya, Tanzania, Malawi, Mozambique, all put together export about 3 to 3.5 lakh tons. So Mozambique has been, say, fluctuating. Average has been 5-6 year average has been 60,000, but last few years has been more, about 100,000, up to 100,000 they have exported. The government of India has signed an agreement with Mozambique to buy about 200,000 tons, which is about 2 lakh tons. But the agreement is quite, how do I put it? It's quite confusing, say, for the local industry there. What exactly this agreement would mean? Would the government would come in and buy? How this agreement would be implemented? That's something that's still not very clear. And then the recent talk about putting up the import duty, how that would actually figure out this agreement. The whole lot of confusion about that. The major pulses that they produce is cowpeas, pigeon peas, and green mungbeans. So green gram and cowpeas is about 12,000 and 15,000 tons. The major is pigeon peas. Sudan has been the new origin into the market. Major variety is pigeon peas. The pigeon pea variety that is coming from Sudan is quite closer to the Myanmar pigeon pea, and the quality is more appreciated in India. The average export has been around 40 to 45,000 tons in the last few years. So it has been a new market, but is quite finding finding good grounds in India. Uganda is its neighbor with Kenya and Tanzania. Major again a player in pulses. Major pulses that are produced are pigeon peas and mung beans. The average is about not too high, about 10,000 metric tons of green gram and pigeon peas is exported. So Uganda has started to look at pigeon peas as a policy, from the policy perspective of the government. They are looking at the promoting pigeon peas, but all these initiatives would take some time to actually step in and give results. So immediate future, I don't see a lot of production increase coming from Uganda, but over a period of 3 to 4 years, you can see Uganda becoming a more important player. New developments, the government of India's MOU with African countries to expand production and promotion of imports from African countries has been talked about, and it has actually excited a lot of African countries to get into pulses processing or pulses production rather. Now this was this started with the discussions about 2 years back, which actually finalized in June, July last year when the Prime Minister visited Mozambique and the agreement was signed. Similar agreements are in pipeline with Kenya, similar agreements are in pipeline with Tanzania and other countries as well. The Indian High Commission in Nigeria has approached the Ministry of Agriculture for a similar type of arrangement. So a lot of push from the government side has been seen to promote agriculture. The package that the government of India is offering is you produce the commodity and we will buy it out at the minimum support price prevailing in India. That gives a comfort to the producer that there is a fixed, there is more or less an assured price that I would get, and that gives the government a comfort about the import quantities. How we would see about in next 1 or 2 years when the actual imports would start to happen and we would start to see the product coming into the country. So that's where pulses export policies have been developed in Kenya, Tanzania, Ethiopia. As I said, I was part of the team that developed that pulses export policy. This is under an initiative called CETA, which is supported by Development Financial Aid of UK. IPG is also an important partner with that. The project CETA stands for Supporting India's Trade and Investment with Africa, where 6 or 7 value chains have been identified, pulses being one of them, where the governments in these countries are being supported to develop more pulses to feed into the Indian market. The studies are showing, and there are enough experts on that matter here in the room, but what I have come across is the studies have been showing that the income elasticity of pulses in India is about 1.5, which means if the per capita income is growing by about 5-6%, the pulses demand would be growing by 1.5 times of it. So we are going to consume more pulses, we are going to have an extended demand for pulses, and to have a long-term equilibrium, promotion of pulses from new origins is what is being looked at. So that under that project, a lot of push has been given to new countries. Support is being offered to new countries to produce and supply more pulses. But again, as I said, this is a long-term horizon. It would take some time to actually get implemented. Recently, the government of India has supported the government of Kenya on agriculture mechanization with about $100 million worth line of credit. A lot of this money is being expected to be invested into pulses processing. Pulses, it's everything. Like mechanization, when they're talking about investing into, say, farm equipment, they're investing into mechanization of the farm, they're investing into building infrastructure for storage, investing into even processing. There's another $30 million line of credit that has been given by the government of India to support processing plants in Kenya. And pulses processing is one of the key sector that the government of India wants to push for in Kenya. So the idea is that more processing facilities should be developed in Kenya so that the international market, international diaspora that is there in UK and the European market and the American market can get pulses supplied from Africa. Kenya and Ethiopia for that matter, Kenya is no longer LDC, but Ethiopia and Tanzania for that matter, because of their status as LDC, get a duty-free exports to American and the European market. So that makes it, it makes a lot of sense for processing facilities to come out there. This has been pushed by the government of India through their SME financing facility of 30 million, where processing plants are being set up. The only condition is any processing plant that is to be set up has to be supported with Indian technological support. So the supply of the processing facilities has to be in India. So that is something which is new coming up. You can see a lot of dal mill being set up in Africa, especially Kenya and Tanzania, which are already producing a lot of pigeon peas, and these dal then getting fed to the European and the regional market and the American market as well. Some value chain initiative interventions have been introduced. Value chain initiatives are majorly donor driven. There are various donor driven, ACDA, MOCA and other donors have stepped into promoting the value chain for pulses in Africa. Kenya has got new varieties through this project, under which 2 to 3 crops a year would come out for pigeon peas. Now, how that pigeon pea, one of the major issues with the pigeon pea that comes from Kenya has been that the processing of that pigeon pea is quite difficult, and the wastage in that in the processing is much higher than average. The skin of the pigeon pea is not easy to peel off, because of which dal processing is quite costly. So that is something that was impediment for imports from Kenya, but now those things have been addressed through new varieties being introduced. Ethiopia is working on developing desi chana variety for India, because their chana that is being produced is much smaller. It's good for processing it into the besan flour, but it's not good for dal processing. They are working on developing new varieties that could actually come and come out in about a year's time, which would be suitable for the Indian market. So those are few developments that are happening. Africa is not an easy terrain, given all those opportunities, huge scope. A lot of people feel that Africa can be a good destination. Yes, Africa is a good destination, but it is not an easy terrain. Mainly, pulses is not a priority crop for most of the farmers in Africa. So you cannot be very sure about the supply. Like what happened last year, a lot of production was pushed up, and then the prices in India tanked, because of which the exports got stuck. Exports did not happen to that level. Now it's that might actually lead to a reduced area under cultivation this year for pulses. So pulses area under cultivation is quite let me put it this way: the farmers are not married to pulses, so they may not actually be pushing only for pulses. So that's a challenge. Market access for importers is not easy. Buying from an African supplier requires a lot of validation checks and infrastructure to actually deal with. So market access is a major issue, which through the CETA project a lot of work has been done, identifying credible processors, credible producers and suppliers who can actually be more dependable in terms of their contract performance is something that the UN is working on with the support of the government of India. And with that, a pool of exporters is being developed from Africa which are reliable, who understand the international business aspect of the pulses and can be good partners for the Indian importers. Issue with quality and contract performances are there. Regulation to fumigation, again, I don't need to speak much about this because you have a lot of experts speaking about that, but that's definitely a challenge. Last time when we had a delegation from Africa coming somewhere in August, and we had detailed discussions with the plant quarantine department as well about this, and this is definitely a challenge. Now with the import duty thing, the market may be in confusion that because the market was produced, our market was promoted saying that we need a lot of pulses and we need to look at Africa for that. And throughout the 2 year effort, the understanding was import duty is not something that was even on the horizon. And now with the import duty thing, the market, at least in Africa, is in confusion that how do we look at the policy dependability in India. So those are few issues about Africa. But yes, the long-term horizon is quite good. This year again, Kenya, Tanzania may be shorter in their production levels. Malawi may be on an average, Ethiopia. If the fumigation issues are shorted out, we can see more imports coming from Ethiopia. So with that, I'll stop here. Thank you very much for your time. And thank you, everybody, for your time.
Any questions? We take the first two questions. Minus the word.
नमस्कार जी, आपने अपने चार्ट में दिखाया कि तंजानिया केनिया में बरसात कम है और नेक्स्ट फसल कम आने की है, तो इसका बरसात जो अब कितने महीने क्रॉप होती है, ये जो आपका 90 डेज की 120 डेज की, उससे कितना क्या फर्क पड़ता है?
तंजानिया और केनिया में जो पिजन पीस की क्रॉप है वो करीब करीब 120 दिन की क्रॉप है. बाकी जो मूंग बीन्स की है वो कुछ वैरायटीज हैं जो 60 से 70 दिन में आ रही हैं.
तो आप लास्ट ईयर से इस ईयर में 75% ग्रोथ में, ऐसा लगता है आपको वो स्विंग 75% स्विंग होगी इस साल?
हाँ, तो एवरेज से 15 से 20% कम होगा, बिकॉज एक तो ड्राउट होने के कारण मेज के प्राइसेस एक्सेसिव हो गए हैं. दूसरी चीज़ ये है कि सीड अवेलेबिलिटी नहीं है. So seed का एक major issue है.
Seed मतलब वो seed भी export हो गए last year.
Seed की जो मतलब जो domestic market है seed का, उसमें pulses की seed, specially pigeon peas की seed expensive हो गई है, availability short है. So उसके कारण ये है. दूसरा monsoon, ये इनका जो बारिश delay हुई है, उसके कारण sowing भी delay हो गया है. So कुछ जो regions में, जैसे जो अनुषा बाबाती जो अभी sowing हो जाना चाहिए था, उसमें अभी सॉरी जो अनुषा बाबाती में जो हार्वेस्टिंग होना चाहिए था वो भी अभी शुरू नहीं हुआ है. उसके अलावा जो मतवारा वेराइटी है और जो मतवारा ओरिजिन है उसका सोइंग अभी होना चाहिए था, वो सोइंग भी डिले हो गया. सो बिकॉज ऑफ दैट द ओवरऑल प्रोडक्शन इज एक्सपेक्टेड टू बी 15-20% शॉर्ट.
तो देसी चिकपी में फर्क पड़ेगा? देसी चिकपी जो तंजानिया में पैदा होता है, इसमें फर्क पड़ेगा?
देसी चिकपीज और पिजन पीज दोनों पे है इसका इम्पैक्ट। थैंक यू।
Now we have the information about Africa, the information about Myanmar will be coming in a short while, but now the rest of the world has been encompassed in just one presentation. Fortunately, we have a gentleman who has been traveling the world. He works for a company, Herada Heads, the company that has a footprint in over 30 countries and is the biggest player in its space. So allow me to get the presentation up before I go away. I think the term I heard recently was called parity. They say that by 2030, artificial intelligence and human intelligence will be equal. That means whatever's now as tools are definitely going to have the same amount of intelligence as us and will be acting on their own. Sometimes I feel we're ahead of time because whatever you load on the computer starts acting on its own. So, right now we're going to start and let us know about the global supply and demand outlook for pulses. Please welcome Managing Director, and he's also the Honorable Chairperson CNS of the ILIOP Promotion Company, but Managing Director of Hakan Agro DMCC, Mr. Sudhakar Tomar.
आपको आवाज आ रही पीछे तक?
सब सो गए थे।
मैं भी कल अभी भी आधिकारिक रूप से इसकी पुष्टि नहीं हुई है, लेकिन ये फ्यूमिगेशन की जो तलवार हम सब लोगों के सर पे काफी दिनों से लटक रही थी, उसका बड़े धीरे से समाधान होता सा दिख रहा है। अभी आधिकारिक तौर से उसकी पुष्टि नहीं हुई है, लेकिन उसके पीछे जो जो लोग भी थे, आईपीजीए के सारे ऑफिस बेयरर्स, कैनेडियन हाई कमीशन की वेरी एनर्जेटिक टीम, बाकी ट्रेड अधिकारी अधिकारिक रूप से डायरेक्टली इनडायरेक्टली काफी सारे लोग उसमें थे, उन सबके बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, उनका अभिनंदन। एक बार उन लोगों के लिए जोर से ताली बजाते हैं जिनकी वजह से हम लोग बने हैं। और उसी सिलसिले में मुझे श्री हरिवंश राय बच्चन जी की कविता याद आ गई, क्योंकि हमारी जो इंडस्ट्री है वो काफी रेजिलिएंट है, मतलब वो हार नहीं मानती है जल्दी से। तो आप लोगों ने शायद कविता सुनी भी होगी कि लहरों से डरकर नौका पार नहीं होती, कोशिश करने वालों की कभी हार नहीं होती। नन्ही चींटी जब दाना लेकर चढ़ती है, चढ़ती दीवारों पर सौ बार फिसलती है, मन का विश्वास रगों में साहस भरता है, चढ़कर गिरना उसको ना अखड़ता है, आखिर उसकी मेहनत बेकार नहीं होती, कोशिश करने वालों की कभी हार नहीं होती। डुबकियां सिंधु में गोताखोर लगाता है, ये खास तौर से ज्यादा रेलेवेंट है मेरे लिए, मैं पिछले 22 साल से दुबई में रह रहा हूं, और दुबई में जो अब आप देख रहे हैं ये पहले नहीं था, क्योंकि दुबई के पास कोई ऑयल की इनकम नहीं है, इट इज ओनली ट्रेड टूरिज्म एंड सर्विस इंडस्ट्री। तो पहले वहां पे ये लोग पर्ल फिशिंग करते थे और उसी से ही काम चलता था। फिर 1930 में अचानक जापानीज और चाइनीज ने आर्टिफिशियल पर्ल बनाना चालू किया, तो ओवरनाइट पूरी कंट्री का सारा बिजनेस खत्म हो गया। तो उन्होंने ट्रेडिंग का एक सिस्टम चालू किया कि टैक्स फ्री हम बनाए ऐसी जगह, कभी भगवान करे यहां भी हमारे यहाँ ऐसा कोई पोर्ट बने कि ड्यूटी फ्री इम्पोर्ट एंड एक्सपोर्ट एंड सर्विस, उससे भी चीज बने। तो पर्ल फिशिंग के लिए काफी जाना जाता है। तो डुबकियां सिंधु में गोताखोर लगाता है, जा जाकर खाली हाथ लौट कर आता है, मिलते नहीं सहज मोती गहरे पानी में, बढ़ता दुगना उत्साह इसी हैरानी में, मुट्ठी लेकिन उसकी खाली हर बार नहीं होती, कोशिश करने वालों की कभी हार नहीं होती। असफलता एक चुनौती है, इसे स्वीकार करो, क्या कमी रह गई है देखो और सुधार करो, संघर्ष का मैदान छोड़ मत भागो तुम, कुछ किए बिना ही जय जय कार्ड नहीं होती, कोशिश करने वालों की कभी हार नहीं होती। तो इस प्रस्तावना के साथ हम लोग थोड़ी सी चर्चा करेंगे कि देश विदेश में ग्लोबली क्या हो रहा है। मेरा काम थोड़ा आसान हो गया है क्योंकि
कनाडा के लिए मिस्टर भारती बैठे हुए हैं, अफ्रीका के लिए मिस्टर कुलकर्णी है, इंडिया के लिए अजय जीत है, तो कुछ जो सवाल जवाब बाद में आप इनसे करते रहिए, मैं खाली आपको बता के दूंगा ज्ञान दूंगा यहाँ पे। तो ये है हमारी पल्सेस, दे लुक वेरी ब्यूटीफुल बट नॉट लाइक दिस व्हेन यू व्हेन यू कुक इट। अगर आप पल्सेस की खाई गूगल में जाके टाइप करें पल्सेस या दाल, तो करीब 4.4 मिलियन रिजल्ट आएंगे, 44 लाख रिजल्ट आएंगे। तो पूरी दुनिया में पल्सेस का जो जो इस्तेमाल है इज वेरी वर्सेटाइल। आप इसको खाने से लगा के स्नैक्स, सॉसेजेस, सैलड्स, हर तरह की चीजों में इसका इस्तेमाल हो सकता है। और ये हमारा वर्तमान है, या जिस तरह से हम पिछले काफी हजार सालों से इस्तेमाल करते रहे पल्सेस को इंडियन सबकॉन्टिनेंट में, और ये इसका फ्यूचर है। अब जो पल्सेस हैं, बिकॉज दे हैव सम वेरी स्पेशल क्वालिटीज जिनके बारे में थोड़ा सा बाद में बताऊंगा मैं आपको, देश विदेश में हर जगह इनको नए नए तरीके से इस्तेमाल किया जा रहा है। सो मच सो ये एक इंपॉर्टेंट स्लाइड है, अगर पीछे नहीं दिख रहा होगा तो मैं आपको थोड़ा समझाऊंगा। पूरी दुनिया में हर साल करीब 3000 टाइप के पल्सेस के ब्रांड लॉन्च होते हैं, हो रहे हैं पिछले 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 5-10 साल से। उसमें से ये चीज सही है कि अभी भी भारतवर्ष का नंबर एक है, क्योंकि 50% हिंदुस्तान से लॉन्च हो रहे हैं, लेकिन 50% इमेजिन करिए 3000 ब्रांड ये बाकी देशों में लॉन्च हो रहे हैं, उसमें मिडिल ईस्ट है, एशिया है, अफ्रीका है, लैटिन अमेरिका है, नॉर्थ अमेरिका है। तो इसका मतलब ये है कि बाकी जगह भी पल्सेस के बारे में जागरूकता, कैसे इसको इस्तेमाल किया जाए, ये बहुत अच्छी पड़ रहा है, ये बहुत अच्छी चीज़ है। इसमें मतलब कोई खराब होने वाली चीज़ नहीं है, हमारे हाथ से कोई चीज़ निकली भी जा रही है। जैसे हमने विश्व को योग दिया है, आयुर्वेद दिया है, बॉलीवुड दिया है, म्यूजिक दिया, उसी तरह से एक तरह से कि पल्सेस को कैसे हमने डेवलप किया, कैसे उसको चैंपियन किया, कैसे उसको बढ़ाया, तो ये दुनिया के लिए भारतवर्ष की देन है। तो ये अच्छी अच्छी चीज है। अब सवाल ये आता है कि हम लोग शक्कर का भी व्यापार करते हैं, गेहूं का भी करते हैं, तो खाली पल्सेस के बारे में इतनी जोर शोर से चर्चा क्यों करते हैं? उसके उसके कई सारे कारण हैं। पल्सेस अदर देन बीइंग अ नाइस थिंग इज ओके, हम लोगों की रोजी रोटी का जरिया है, उससे पैसे कमाते हैं हम लोग, अच्छी चीज है। लेकिन उसके अलावा दिस इज द ओनली प्रोड्यूस इन एग्रीकल्चर वर्ल्ड विच यूजेस द लीस्ट अमाउंट ऑफ वाटर। आप इसका अनुमान ये लगाइए कि 1 किलो पल्सेस के लिए हमको जरूरत पड़ती है 358 लीटर पानी पूरे पूरे क्रॉप के साइकिल में। और इसी चीज को अगर मेरे मुझे 1 किलो बीफ बनाना हो, काओ या बफलो, उसके लिए मुझे पानी इस्तेमाल करना पड़ता है 15,506 लीटर के बराबर। तो 4,400% ज्यादा मेरे को पानी लगता है उसमें। पल्सेस के अंदर ये भी बड़ी अच्छी चीज है दलहन में कि ये अपना फर्टिलाइजर खुद बनाते हैं, ये नाइट्रोजन फिक्स करते हैं मिट्टी में। तीसरी चीज, जैसे कि हर चीज के लिए आपको ऑयल, नेचुरल गैस की जरूरत पड़ती है, पेट्रोलियम, वनस्पत वीट के या कॉर्न के पल्सेस में आपको सिर्फ 50% एनर्जी लगती है। सो दीज आर एनर्जी एफिशिएंट, वाटर एफिशिएंट एंड नाइट्रोजन फिक्सेस, दीज आर द 3 एग्रोनॉमिक बेनिफिट जिसके लिए इनकी इनकी जरूरत है। दूसरी चीज है कि पल्सेस आर द ओनली एग्रीकल्चर प्रोड्यूस अवेलेबल इन मास विच आर नॉन जीएमओ, दे आर नॉट जेनेटिकली मॉडिफाइड, दे आर ऑल्सो नॉन ग्लूटेन, बिकॉज ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड देयर इज अ वेरी सिग्निफिकेंट ऑफ पोर्शन ऑफ पॉपुलेशन विच हैज एलर्जी फ्रॉम ग्लूटेन। सो द नॉन ग्लूटेन, लो एलर्जी एंड ऑल्सो मेजर सोर्स ऑफ प्रोटीन एज इंग्रीडियंट, फाइबर एंड फीड। हम लोग तो यहाँ पर खाली दाल इस्तेमाल करते हैं, लेकिन बाकी दुनिया में बहुत जगह इसको फीड में भी इस्तेमाल करते हैं, या इसका इससे प्रोटीन निकालते हैं, एक्सट्रैक्शन करते हैं। बाकी चीजों के मुकाबले में दे कंपेयर वेरी वेल। इनमें जो प्रोटीन का जो जो प्रोटीन का हिस्सा है प्रोसेस में, इट इज एज गुड एज चिकन। तो अगर आप चिकन नहीं खाते तो अगर उतना पोर्शन का प्रोसेस खाते हैं, दिस इज एज गुड एज फूड। नॉट द वे समटाइम्स वी कंज्यूम, छिलका उतार के तड़का लगा के घी डाल के उसकी बिल्कुल हत्या कर देते हैं, वो नहीं करना चाहिए। जितना ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा आप उसको छिलके वाली दाल ज़्यादा खा सकें या होल खा सकें, वो सबसे अच्छी चीज़ है। पूरा जो ग्लोबल इंडस्ट्री का बेस इज अबाउट 17 मिलियन टन्स, जिसकी वैल्यू है करीब $100 बिलियन, एंड उसमें से करीब 14 मिलियन टन का विश्व व्यापार होता है, जिसकी की कीमत करीब $20 बिलियन की। ये है रफ एस्टिमेट है ग्लोबल पल्स इंडस्ट्री। Unfortunately, compared to other products, it has not grown so well. आप देखिएगा कि जैसे पीछे नहीं दिखा होगा, गेहूं, मक्का, राइस और सोयाबीन में पिछले 5 दशकों में, 50 सालों में करीब 200 से 800% की वृद्धि हुई है. 200 से 800%. This is a huge crop, a huge increase. पल्सन में अनफॉर्चुनेटली 1960 में जब प्रोडक्शन 40 मिलियन था, आज तक करीब 70, सिर्फ 30 मिलियन टन बढ़ा है, जो कि करीब 8% हर साल लगभग उसकी मात्रा है. उसका कारण यह था कि पल्सेस के ऊपर इट वॉज कंसिडर्ड अ कॉम्प्लिकेटेड क्रॉप, डिफिकल्ट क्रॉप, पुअर मैन्स क्रॉप, तो ज्यादा उसके ऊपर रिसर्च की फंडिंग नहीं आई. पल्सेस को इस लेवल तक लेके आने के लिए कम से कम दलहनों के लिए $177 मिलियन रिसर्च चाहिए हर साल. दिस इज द काइंड ऑफ मनी रिक्वायर्ड टू टेक पल्सेस टू द लेवल ऑफ अदर मेजर क्रॉप्स. उसके लिए छोटी सी शुरुआत आपके आपका जो संगठन है सीसीएल्स, पहले सीसीएल्स था, अभी तो ग्लोबल पल्स कॉन्फेडरेशन है, तो उन लोगों ने 2003 में ये शुरुआत की और 2013 माइनस थी, और करीब 3-4 साल की बहुत ही मेहनत के बाद they were successful in getting 2016 as the year of pulses. So 2016 का साल अंतरराष्ट्रीय दलहन वर्ष के रूप में उनको इसमें सफलता मिली, और उसके लिए अभी तक करीब करीब $20 मिलियन $125 करोड़ रुपए का कमिटमेंट हो चुका है इंडस्ट्री से. उसमें बहुत सारे आप लोगों ने योगदान दिया है, एसोसिएशन ने दिया है, क्रिकेट पल्सेस ने दिया, बहुत सारे लोगों ने दिया है. तो उसमें सबसे जो बड़ा बेनिफिट हुआ है, इन्होंने तरह तरह की चीजें और इवेंट्स ऑर्गेनाइज किए. 2016 में नवंबर 2015 से फरवरी 2017 के बीच करीब 15 महीने के अंतराल में 700 मिलियन करीब 70 करोड़ इंप्रेशंस और लाइक्स हैव बीन जनरेटेड. दैट मींस कि 70 करोड़ लोगों के पास ये चीज पहुंची है, उनके बारे में प्रोसेस के बारे में उनको जानकारी हुई है. दिस इज अ ह्यूज अनप्रेसिडेंटेड रीच ऑफ पल्सेस, अवेयरनेस फॉर पल्सेस टू द वर्ल्ड पॉपुलेशन. ये पहले ऐसा कभी नहीं हुआ. दिस इज हिस्टोरिक. अब कुछ बात करते हैं कि क्या कहां कहां से क्या क्या पल्सेस हैं. दीज आर द मेजर प्रोड्यूसर्स एंड प्रोडक्ट्स, लेंटिल्स, पीज एंड चिकपीज. अगर आप 8 देशों के बारे में अपनी जानकारी बराबर रखें, उसमें इंडिया ऑफकोर्स द बिगेस्ट एलिफेंट इन द रूम, कैनेडा, ऑस्ट्रेलिया, रशिया, यूनाइटेड स्टेट्स, पाकिस्तान, टर्की, फ्रांस एंड ऑस्ट्रेलिया, तो आपको कम से कम ये जो 3 प्रोडक्ट है, लेंटिल्स, पीस, मटर, चना और मसूर दाल, पीली और लाल दोनों, तो इसमें आपको कम से कम आपकी 80% जानकारी इन 8 देशों को फॉलो करने में हो जाएगी. सवेरे उठ के आप पता कर लेंगे 8 देशों में क्या हो रहा है, खरीफ देश में, ऑफर्स में, सॉइल मॉइस्चर में या वेदर में, तो आपकी जानकारी काफी अपडेट रहेगी इसमें. ये एक स्लाइड है कि पीछे मुझे पीछे पूरा संदेह नहीं, पूरा विश्वास है कि किसी को नहीं दिख रहा होगा, मुझे नहीं दिख रहा यहाँ से इतना सारा डेटा है इसमें, लेकिन ये प्रेजेंटेशन अवेलेबल होगा, आप इसमें देख सकते हैं. इसमें हर प्रोडक्ट के सबसे 5 कहाँ कहाँ से एक्सपोर्ट हो रहा है, कहाँ कहाँ जा रहा है, उससे आपको इसकी पूरी जानकारी मिल जाएगी. इसमें बस खाली आपको संक्षिप्त में बताता हूँ कि कनाडा सबसे बड़ा प्रोड्यूसर है लेंटल्स में, एंड द मेन मार्केट्स आर इंडिया, पाकिस्तान, टर्की, यूएई एंड श्रीलंका. चिकपीज इज अगेन ऑस्ट्रेलिया इज द बिगेस्ट, सॉरी ऑस्ट्रेलिया इज द बिगेस्ट एक्सपोर्टर फॉर चिकपीज, एंड इंडिया, बांग्लादेश, यूएई आर द बिग मार्केट्स. काबुली चने के लिए यूएई, अल्जीरिया, टर्की, स्पेन, दीज आर द बिग मार्केट्स फॉर काबुली. इंडिया इज द लार्जेस्ट एक्सपोर्टर. मटर के लिए बिटवीन कनाडा एंड रशिया आई थिंक दे शेयर द बल्क ऑफ एक्सपोर्ट, एंड द मेन मार्केट्स आर इंडिया, चाइना एंड बांग्लादेश, दीज आर द 3. यहाँ पे थोड़ा सा ये बताना सही रहेगा कि कनाडा इज 41% ऑफ ग्लोबल ट्रेड, ग्लोबल ट्रेड. नंबर 2 इज आई थिंक मेन, लेट मी गेट यू, या नंबर 2 इज ऑस्ट्रेलिया 12%, नंबर 3 इज म्यांमार 11%, नंबर 4 इज यूएसए 10%, एंड चाइना इज एट नंबर 5 विद 7%. So let me go back to that slide again. So okay, let's talk about the trend. So global export for dalhan for all these reasons, jitne maine uske उसके बारे में बताए थे उनके उनके बारे में कि क्यों इसकी महत्ता बढ़ रही है इंटरनेशनल मार्केट में. ग्लोबल एक्सपोर्ट्स आर स्लोली राइजिंग और जो बेसिक सेकुलर ट्रेंड है द प्रोडक्शन इन इज ग्रोइंग टू मच इन कैनेडा यूएस एंड हिस्टोरिकल ट्रेंड स्पेशली इन कंज्यूमिंग मार्केट्स स्टेट इंडिया पाकिस्तान और टर्की इज डिक्लाइनिंग विद द ऑफ कोर्स विद द वेलकम एक्सेप्शन ऑफ दिस ईयर. इस साल जो हुआ है हिंदुस्तान में 22 मिलियन टन दिस इज अभूतपूर्व हिस्टोरिक मतलब इसके लिए यहाँ का जो किसान है हार्ड वर्किंग अनपढ़ लेकिन अनाड़ी किसान नहीं आता अनपढ़ है लेकिन अनाड़ी किसान नहीं है. गवर्नमेंट की पॉलिसी इज ऑल्सो वेरी गुड फॉर लास्ट टू ईयर्स प्रो एग्रीकल्चर प्रो फार्मिंग विच इज वॉट वी नीड. हिंदुस्तान में 68% जनता गाँव में है जो डायरेक्टली इनडायरेक्टली खेती से भी निर्भर है. उस आदमी की इनकम दुगनी की जगह कम से कम 5 गुनी होनी चाहिए क्योंकि अगर आपका 68% आपकी पॉपुलेशन का जीडीपी में कंट्रीब्यूशन सिर्फ 16% है इट्स अ मैटर ऑफ शेम. उसको कम से कम 5 से 10 गुना होना चाहिए तब आपका देश तरक्की कर सकता नहीं तो हम सब लोग वो सारा टैक्स भरते रहेंगे बचा सकते. So, in terms of superstars of pulses exporters, of course, we have these 5 countries, Canada, Australia, Myanmar, USA, China. In terms of importer superstars, we have again have India, Pakistan, China, Egypt, Turkey, UAE, these are the major markets. ये है विश्व का global calendar. जो लाल रंग की line है, ये होती है कि कब आपने फसल की कटाई की और हरे रंग की line है कब वहाँ पे sowing हो रही है. तो ये इतना इंटरेस्टिंग विषय है पल्सेस का दहन का. मुझे कोई भी 12 महीनों में से एक महीना ऐसा नहीं मिला जिसने कि हमारे इन मेजर देशों में कुछ ना कुछ एक्टिविटी ना हो रही हो. तो आप इतने अच्छे व्यापार में हैं कि आपको एक किसी भी क्षण ये आराम नहीं होगा कि आपके पास काम नहीं है. आपके पास कुछ ना कुछ हल्ला मचाने के लिए झगड़ा करने के लिए कुछ ना कुछ है. वेरी डाइवर्सिफाइड बेस ऑफ ट्रेड विच इज अनलाइक एनी अदर कंट्री. इफ यू आर वीक Unfortunately, despite the production rising to 70 million tons from 46 million tons in 1960, the per capita consumption, per व्यक्ति औसत जो है, वो थोड़ा सा नीचे जा रहा है. तो लोगों में अभी इस चीज की जागरूकता और ज्यादा बढ़ाने की जरूरत है हमारी तरफ से, संघ की तरफ से, आप सब लोगों की तरफ से. और ये ट्रेंड खाली यहाँ नहीं, दुनिया में सब जगह है कि हम सब लोगों के बच्चे को दाल को खिलाने में बड़ी परेशानी होती है. वो पिज़्ज़ा खाना चाहते हैं, दे वॉन्ट टू ईट बर्गर्स. बट उसके लिए हमको कुछ ऐसी इनोवेटिव चीज़ें करनी पड़ेंगी जिससे कि वो ये चीज़ें खाएं या नहीं खाएं तो इसकी इसका जो बेनिफिट है उनको किस तरह से पहुंचे उसके बारे में हम लोगों की चर्चा करनी है. ये है वर्ल्ड सप्लाई एंड डिमांड. इसके लिए थोड़ा सा मुझे कागज का सहारा लेना पड़ेगा बिकॉज मैं आपको मिसलीड नहीं करना चाहता हूँ. पीछे जो बैठे हैं उनको नंबर नहीं दिख रहा है. '60 के बाद और अभी तक के बीच में 2016 was an exceptional year. एक अभूतपूर्व साल इसलिए था बिकॉज दिस ईयर वी लाइक टू कॉल एक्सेप्शनल ईयर ऑफ प्लेंटी. ये पहली बार ऐसा साल था जब 3 मिलियन टन 30 लाख टन एक्सेस परसेस हुआ जिसका कि सीधे का सीधा हमने देखा असर क्राइसिस के ऊपर. सो In 2017, the pulses availability will be the production will be about 55.12 million tons, which is 0.7% higher than 2016. Lekin 3 million ton ka jo carryover hai, wo agar isme jud jayega, to aapka jo total availability hai 2017 mein, wo ho jayegi 58.25, which is 3 million tons higher. And this explains the bearish sentiments in the market. It's simple supply and demand. ये sheet है peas की. Peas में global production 2017 में, जब 2017 की बात कर रहा हूँ, so I'm talking about from January to December. 2017 में 8% बढ़ जाएगा, which will become 12.96, about 13 million tons. जो कि पिछले साल 14 मिलियन टन था, इसमें करीब 8% का 8% की कमी है। ग्लोबल लेंटिल प्रोडक्शन, दिस इज नॉट ग्लोबल, आई एम नॉट टॉकिंग अबाउट कैनेडा, ऑल द कंट्रीज, ग्लोबल लेंटिल प्रोडक्शन इज विल कम डाउन आल्सो 4% टू 6.26 मिलियन टन्स वर्सेस 6.52 मिलियन टन्स इन 2016-17। चिकपीज प्रोडक्शन बोथ थोड़ा सा डिफरेंट स्टोरी ऑफ है, बोथ फॉर देसी एंड काबुली, इसके आगे मैं ब्रेकडाउन भी दूंगा उसका। इसमें करीब 11% इंक्रीज होगा 2017 में, और ये इसकी संख्या है 13.18 मिलियन मेट्रिक टन वर्सेस 11.97 मिलियन मेट्रिक टन 2016। बीन्स आर समवॉट साइडवेज विद 2.5% increase in production to 22.7 million tons versus 22.13 million tons in 2016. Now, in summary, we are looking, if you look at all these charts, the charts for the top line is lentils, only these two are peas, with the exception of Kabuli chickpeas and desi chickpeas. Mostly they are showing downward trend. And as we said, it is not the right time to predict for 2017-18 cycle because we are still in March, and किसान दुनिया में कहीं का भी हो बहुत ही intelligent होता है, आप उसको कम मत समझिए, वो last moment तक सोचेगा, देखेगा, and then he will decide what they have to do. Of course, there is a certain area, tonnage, acreage which we have to do because of crop rotation, but other than that, if they are not getting the right signal, whether it be India और कनाडा और ऑस्ट्रेलिया, आपको तब तक पता नहीं चलेगा कि कितना हम लोगों के पास है, लेकिन अगर अच्छा प्राइस का सिग्नल गया तो हम अपने खलिहान के नीचे भी जमीन है वहां भी हम चना बो देंगे, सो दैट इज आल्सो फॉर श्योर। अब थोड़ी सी चार पांच कुछ ट्रेंड्स के बारे में जल्दी से बात कर लेते हैं, उससे कि क्या क्या हो रहा है जो कि अदर देन बाइंग एंड सेलिंग विच वी डू एवरीडे, अदर देन राइजिंग इनकम, growth of middle class in the Indian subcontinent and the emerging markets, and changing eating habits. There are six things for which pulses are being appreciated and being known. These are new things. Number one is that pulses are being projected by exporting nations that this is the only non-GMO produce, which is a big deal in Europe, in North America. Not so much here, but it's a big deal. They are also gluten free. That means that you don't get allergy by eating pulses, or you don't get problems which are associated with gluten. They are also non or very low allergic. That means pulses do not have any ingredient which gives you allergy. It is being viewed as a food ingredient processing. So if the global food processing industry realizes, and which they are realizing, that's why you have 700 million likes and impressions in only 1 year. If they start using pulses as an ingredient in their snacks, in their chips, in their burgers, in their pastries, in their pastas, this will unleash such a big impact on the pulse industry which is unimaginable. And pulses are being targeted as a healthy superfood and sustainable because they are good for soil, good for farmers, and good for environment. These are six trends which are propelling pulses demand not only in the traditional markets like India but globally. Farmers all over the world, they will grow where they make money. Simple. By way of MSP, direct bonus, indirect bonus, direct prices, they are not concerned. If they do not get enough money, they will not grow. So we have to remunerate them as much as possible. It is my belief, if I can eat 750 rupees of pizza, I can buy dal at whatever price possible. This is my belief, that we should be ready to pay that price. South Asian consumers, especially in the emerging markets, will buy something which is affordable, cheap, unless it becomes an aspirational food. Sometimes things are so aspirational that even if they are more expensive, they still buy. Developing countries will keep improving their yields, so the way the whole world became surprised as if India has done something amazing by producing 22 million tons. No. If we need something, the government support is there, the production can be enhanced to a level like 22 million tons was unimaginable till few years ago, but we achieved that, so that's something amazing. Government interventions in those countries which are population driven, where the food is a basic necessity, roughly In India, the average person spends about 50% of the money on the food. So wherever this kind of money is being spent on food, the government will intervene. They have every right to intervene. So please be ready with that. Please be ready with the fumigation problem. Please be ready with the stock limit. These things are bound to happen. Consolidation will lead to shorter value chain. That means from farm to fork, from production to destination, the chain will become shorter. So much so that you will have direct producers having their own base and destinations and distribution, so this chain will become shorter. This is becoming shorter all over the world. Intense, and that will lead to intense market share for competition. So market is going to get competitive, but nothing to worry. Bazaar ka size itna bada hai, usme, this is another very interesting thing about, ye sirf ek akela aisa vyapar hai, ki isme $100 billion wali company bhi hai, aur 5 container wale bhi hai, aur dono ka gujara hai, dono saath saath baith ke bilkul aaram se kaam kar rahe. This is another beautiful thing about the concept today. New origins, aise aise countries se daale aa rahi hai, jinka main naam bhi nahi sun, uske baad mein dekhna padta hai ki country kahan pe hai, isme se kya kya cheezein nikal rahi hai. तो इस सब इस संदर्भ में हम लोगों का जो स्वार्थ वाला क्वेश्चन था कि हमारा क्या इसमें इस सब चीज से मुझे क्या मिलने वाला है, ये शीट है जिसमें कि अगले 15-20 साल तक एक दशक के अंदर कि हिंदुस्तान में कितनी दालें चाहिए होंगी. दिस इज नॉट अ प्राइवेट प्रोजेक्शन, दिस इज अ प्रोजेक्शन बाय द गवर्नमेंट दैट एट करंट लेवल ऑफ प्रोडक्शन एट करंट लेवल ऑफ डिमांड. दिस इज मेड बाय इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ पर्सनल रिसर्च कानपुर. It is indeed their number that in 2030, which is not far, only a matter of decade, we will need 32 million tons. And today we are sitting at 22 million tons, historic high number. So 10 to 12 million tons additional number we have to grow, generate, import, process. Somehow we have to get this from somewhere. So there is a huge opportunity for processing, trading, supply chain, import, export, support industries, logistics, it is there. So this, we are in a very important and big market segment. Food globally is a $5 trillion business, $5 trillion. And in next 40 years, paraphrasing the president of GPC, in next 40 years, we will have to grow food which we grew in last 10,000 years. अगले 40 साल में हमको उतना चीजें दाल दलहन अनाज ग्रो करना पड़ेगा जो हमने सब मिला के पिछले 10,000 साल में उगाया है. दिस इज द काइंड ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटी वी आर सिटिंग एट. ये अगर आप ये मैप देखेंगे, सो द नंबर ऑफ द मिडिल मैप द सेंट्रल मैप इज द नंबर ऑफ द कंट्रीज आर डिस्प्रोपोर्शनेट बिकॉज जो कंट्री में जितने ज्यादा मैल नरिश्ड होंगे उसका साइज उतना बड़ा दिया गया. Left side mein is the food security. The darker colors are the country most vulnerable for the food security. Right side is the protein intake. So lighter countries need more protein. So in vegetable protein intake has gone from 61% up from 2000 to 2014. Pichle kareeb 5 saalon mein 61% consumption of vegetable protein is increasing because of health benefits, because of awareness, what is good for you or not. And unfortunately or fortunately, 87% of this comes from those proteins which are not fully digestible, like soybean and gluten, like wheat. And not so much in India, but globally there is a perception that these are gluten, so they're not really suitable and they are genetically modified. Versus pulses, which do not have this kind of preconceived notion or this kind of stigma attached to it. So, pea protein right now is just 2% of the global market. But it increased 46% in the last 2 years. 46% increase in the pea protein market. And average growth rate is 14.5%. 15% ke hisab se globally ye industry bad rahi hai. So just to give you a flavor, sirf ye protein segment is about $44 billion. So there is a huge opportunity. It's a huge market for all these industry players to participate in this. So the take-home message is grow more pulses, eat more pulses, trade more pulses, use more pulses, promote pulses, because they're not only good for your pocket, also they are good for all the marginal farmers all over the world. They give way to healthy living, good for soil environment, and they also help environment for to fight climate change. आखिर में थोड़ी सी फिर पब्लिसिटी कर लेता हूँ. 2017 में there's a global convention. IPGA is a very core pillar and member of Global Pulse Configuration. This is happening in Vancouver, July 10 to 13. काफ़ी लोग इकट्ठे होंगे वहाँ पे. आप सब लोग आए और इस चीज़ को बहुत अच्छे से सफल बनाए. आप लोगों ने इतने अच्छी तरह से सुना, उसके लिए बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद. आज दिन भर मैं यहाँ पे होगा, कोई सवाल जवाब के लिए हाजिर होगा. धन्यवाद.
Thank you, Mr. Tovar. Yes, madam. You need a mic. One last quick question because we're running short of time now. Oh, okay, please. Please, Mr. Tovar.
You mentioned all the countries you tried for fumigation to the government. I think you forgot to mention US. Our delegates came first in first week of February.
बहुत बहुत माफी उसके लिए. मैंने बोला कि सब लोग जो भी इसके पीछे हैं सबका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद. यूनाइटेड स्टेट्स ऑफ अमेरिका का ट्रेड कमीशन का सबसे ज्यादा धन्यवाद.
Our next presentation is on the global crop and trade outlook for Myanmar. We have Mr. Shyam Nursery, as he said, the presentation on.
Dear friends, I am Shyam Nursery from Avi International, here today to present about Myanmar purchase crop and export outlook for the past few years and subsequent rate 2017. Before we move to Urad Tour and Move, it is very important for us to say some facts and recent developments in Myanmar. To start with some facts of Myanmar, language, capital, population, language, currency, principal exports that include rice, precision beans, marine products, minerals, gems, and natural gas. The Myanmar Investment Commission, MIC, recently announced that the country's new investment law will come into force for the financial year starting April 2017. In addition to a revamped approval process, the investment law empowers the government to direct foreign investment through the use of tax incentives targeting key industries and underdeveloped regions. Myanmar's least developed areas will be classified as Zone 1, allowing income tax exemptions of up to 7 years. Zone 2 refers to areas at a middle stage of development which carry exemptions of up to 5 years. The most developed areas are Zone 3 and have tax exemptions lasting up to 3 years. Additionally, the government can offer tax incentives to promoted industries which tend to be labor intensive, such as manufacturing, infrastructure, agriculture, and food processing. Myanmar's geographic location at the intersection of China and India, two of the world's most dynamic economies, makes it well positioned to resume its traditional role as a regional trading hub and a key supplier of agricultural produce. As the largest country in mainland Southeast Asia, Myanmar has one of the lowest population densities in the region, with fertile land, significant untapped agricultural potential, and rich endowment of natural resources. Agriculture is the backbone of Myanmar's economy, as it contributes 38% of GDP, 70% of labor force, and 30% of export earnings for the country. As Mr. Sartre mentioned just now, that India's 68% population is engaged in agriculture and just add 16% to the GDP. I think Myanmar is better off, almost double. There are a lot of opportunities with some constraints in Myanmar agriculture. Opportunities include strategic location, favorable agro ecozones, uncultivated land, resource endowment, democratic new government, favorable environment to grow specialty food market, new foreign investment law 2017. Constraints include lack of human resource development, lack of research and development, lack of market infrastructure, and lack of financial and legislative framework. Myanmar has surprised the purchase world not only with quality, quantity, but also with the variety. The main export of beans and pulses from Myanmar include black mape, two hole, green moonbeam, chickpeas, gram hole, red pinny beans, butter beans, lovla beans, and bamboo beans.